It's been a wild, wild, wild World Series of Bowling. The best players on the planet have lit it up in the month-long extravaganza that's worth over $2.1 million in prize money. But the best may be yet to come as reigning PBA Player of the Year Wes Malott, the Big Nasty, makes his first show of the new season. The PBA Shark Championship is next. We are still in Detroit for our continuing coverage of the World Series of Bowling here on ESPN. Here's the rundown for today's matches. Semifinal number one on the men's side, Michael Fagan versus Jason Couch. Semi number two, Wes Malott versus Jack Jurek. The finals of the men's a little bit later in the broadcast. And then the PBA Women's Series presented by Bowl.com has Kelly Kulick taking on CDB Carolyn Dorin-Ballard. Rob Stone joined by 13-time tireless Randy Peterson. Randy, over the last couple weeks here in Detroit, we've really seen it all. We've seen probably the most challenging conditions these bowlers will ever face in their careers. We've seen first-time winners. We've seen Hall of Famers. But one thing has been missing. One big thing. The Big Nasty, last year's reigning Player of the Year, Wes Malott, finally makes his season debut today.
Yeah, you're right. He got off to a slow start here at the World Series of Bowling, and you thought we would have seen him last week at the Scorpion Championships because he is, however, the Scorpion King. Didn't happen. He did make it to the round of eight, however. But this week, he's back on television again here at the Shark Championship. He said it's his least favorite pattern, but keep in mind, he won his first ever career title on this very pattern. But Rob, I think the player to watch today is our lone southpaw, Jason Couch. Jason Couch coming back after a year and a half from knee surgery. He says he's back to 100% and poised to win again.
Really, it's just been a hard time getting back to where I was before my injury. I felt like I was at the top at the point, you know, and I didn't think I was necessarily ready for surgery, but it's probably a good thing I went in, you know, because I probably wouldn't have made another 2 years without my knee surgery. So it's just been a grind.
Couch looking for his 16th tour title. Fagan his second, but his first in singles competition. And we'll begin with Jason Couch, and he was telling me earlier, I hope I bowl this first match because the more bowling these lanes take, the easier he thinks it's going to become for the righties. Why is that, Randy?
They start to break down the oil pattern and create a little bit of dry to the right, and they can move into that soup in the middle of the lane and throw into the dry spot. And Jason absolutely excels on the long patterns. You remember, he's the only player in PBA history to win three consecutive Tournament of Champions, all done on long oil patterns. And we're talking 50 feet. Shark, this season, 43 feet. This is in his wheelhouse, and he's got the whole left side of the lane to himself.
Made just one telecast last season. He finished fourth in Vernon Hills. That also happened to be on this Shark oil pattern.
Two.
Whoa. Now, we have seen that week in and week out here at the World Series of Bowling. I mean, nothing can be taken for granted out here.
Well, in all of the matches, as you know, they look like they're going in one direction only to finish in another. So I wouldn't be worried just yet.
Strong start, though, for Michael Fagan. It was a slow start overall here at the World Series of Bowling for him. 26th in the Motor City event, 12th at Cheetah, 46th in the Viper, 58th in the Chameleon, and then 51st in the Scorpion. But he turned things around here in the Shark, making his eighth career televised singles appearance, three of them coming last season. Twice he has been a runner-up, a native of Patch Hog, New York, on Long Island.
So, Rob, what is it you're trying to say? The World Series of Bowling hasn't been kind to Michael Fagan?
It has not been kind to the averages of many a bowler.
But you can see with that extreme high rep rate for both players, not a lot of motion down the lane. Look at that high backswing, the cup snap of the wrist at the bottom.
Fagan's been doing some work on his game in the offseason. We'll talk about that a little bit later as Jason Couch steps up. 15 titles, four of them majors. He will be eligible for the Hall of Fame in 2011. You have to think he'll get it that year or soon after. Drops them all, and speaking of Hall of Fame, a grave injustice if you, my friends, are not in this upcoming season.
Who are you talking about?
I'm talking about you. I'm going to personally see to it that you're in the Hall of Fame because deserved it. You deserved it last year.
Well, thanks, Rob. I appreciate that. A great shot there by Jason Couch. You know, when talking with Jason, we have a lot in common. I went through knee surgery back in the early 90s. Jason Couch coming back from knee surgery a year and a half ago. And when talking with him, he said, hey, you know what? My knee's about 90%, but I finally now feel like my game is 100%. His key is to not get stacked up on top of that right knee. Keep your weight back, get some knee bend, and stay behind it.
Back-to-back jacks there for Jason.
Well, what a great move Jason Couch just made here in the third frame. Here's his first frame on this left lane. You get some Cats information from the Kegel Training Center. You can see that that shot goes light. So what does he do? He gets up in the third frame, moves a little bit more to the inside, takes out a stronger bowling ball. Perfect result. That's what being a professional is all about. Hey, Rob Stone, how about a little Lumber Liquidators Know the Wood?
I would love that right now.
Well, this is Shark. It's the longest of the named patterns at 43 feet. There is a sea of oil to the outside part of the lane. On both sides, some buildup in the middle. The players try to break down that heavy, heavy oil pattern and move towards the center part of the lane.
And by the way, you may actually catch a glimpse of the Shark oil pattern. They have a rendition of it right there over on lane 8, so all the fans watching the action can see exactly what the bowlers are battling oil-wise. Here's Fagan.
3-for-3 for Michael Fagan. Started last year slow. Picked it up in the second half. Made some adjustments. Made a good run. Made some shows. Came in close in some others. But again, he mentioned, you know, a slow start this year. Frustrating time here at the World Series of Bowling. New sponsor. Changed equipment. Not a whole lot of time in the offseason to prepare that equipment. So he's been doing a lot of experimenting this month. Drilled a ton of balls, probably the most of anyone on the PBA Tour this year. He's hit about 20 balls he's already drilled. He feels now he's kind of found his comfort zone, finally.
Take a look what Michael Fagan has done on this left lane. Here's his first shot. This one ends up perfect. That's right around fifth arrow. As you can see, all it takes is a little bit of speed and a little bit wide of target for the ball not to make it back. That's what he just did in the fourth.
Oh, boy. Oh, man.
Oof, chopped the double wood.
That's not an easy spare on this.
Wow. And again, this is something you expect. Someone will drop for a spare, but not at the World Series of Bowling. Couch Fagan semi number one continues when we return to the World Series of Bowling's Shark Championship.
The PBA Shark Championship is brought to you by Lumber Liquidators, hardwood flooring for less. By Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. By Bayer Aspirin, expect wonders. And by the United States Bowling Congress, the all-new bowl.com, your online source for all things bowling. Log on to bowl.com today. We welcome you back to ESPN's continuing coverage of the World Series of Bowling, coming your way from just outside of Detroit. While we were away, Jason Couch in the fourth, leaving the 6-7-9. Tough pickup, but
baby,
he was able to convert the spare. And then Couch in the fifth, leaves the three pin and makes that spare as well. Fagan in the fifth,
strike. Ditto in the sixth, and Fagan, you're really starting to see that confidence come out in the youngster right now. We go back to live action. Couch up in the sixth. Well, confidence was something that was missing in Jason Couch's game early on here at the World Series of Bowling. But the confidence is back after finishing 17th at the Scorpion Championship last week and making the show this week here on the Shark. His 17th year on the tour. Well, he's had some nice spare conversions today. There's his pregnant wife, Kim. Due in mid-February, bringing the total to four kids in the Couch household.
See the right move. Yes.
There's his third strike of this match, coming in the seventh frame. That'll help cut into the deficit. Jason hasn't won since late January of 2007 when he took the Motel 6 Classic in Henderson, Nevada. Again, Michael Fagan still seeking his first singles Lumber Liquidators PBA Tour title. Come on, 10!
All right, good shot. Good shot.
Everyone wants to know, when is Fagan going to win that first title? And that's something he gets asked quite a bit.
I think a lot of people are, you know, wanting to know when I'm going to do it. But in my opinion, I think that it's going to happen. And, you know, when I do win one, you know, it could open the floodgates and I could just get in a little groove and hopefully win a bunch.
Rob, I think he's got a bright future. I think with the experience that he's getting by being on television along with a great physical game, as soon as he ties the two together, you know, he's going to win a lot of events out here. And who knows, it might just happen today for him.
His sixth strike of this match. Jason Couch now steps up in the eighth, looking for his fourth and looking for a double.
And Jason Couch now knows that it's crunch time. I got to throw two more right here so I end up with a three-bagger. That's all that's going through his mind right now.
I like that one. Come on. Oh, you got to be kidding me.
He went high the last time on that lane, made the adjustment, threw it really, really good to only leave a six pin.
Well, he's one of the most successful bowlers of all time, but Jason Couch will admit he had a rough start to his pro career.
First 2 weeks I bowled, no cash. Call my mom from Vegas, coming home. I don't have what it takes to be out here. And she said, that's fine. All your stuff will be on the lawn. Pack it up. Get in your car. Go get a job. I went, all right, Mom, I'll stick it out a few more weeks. Here we are, 2009, 15 titles later, and have had a blast out here.
Oh.
Well, Kim knows the score, and she knows that it's not looking real good right now, and Jason Couch is going to need a lot of help from Michael Fagan. Spare here, he's going to be at 191. He can strike out for 201. His wife, Kim, actually a former media director for the PBA. So she knows how to keep score, Rob.
Fagan, you look at the scoreboard today for him in the semifinal. I don't see a bad shot. Yes, he had an open frame in the fourth where he kind of picked one out of the double wood, but even that leave wasn't all that bad.
It's just a little light.
Yeah, baby, come on, just
Now, seems to be getting out of his shell right there.
That's daddy lockups there, babe. Michael Fagan's going to bowl for the title here at the Shark Championship. Look at that shot. It's good stuff there. Good stuff.
D for done. Fagan moves on to the title match of the PBA Shark Championship. And when we return, it's semifinal number two. Oh, the big nasty is back. Last season's Player of the Year, Wes Malott, takes on the veteran, Jack Jurek. So semifinal number one of the PBA Shark Championship in the book. Michael Fagan wins it 224 to 201 over Jason Couch. Time now for semifinal number two. Wes Malott, the reigning player of the year, taking on Jack the Ripper Jurek.
I was wondering how
long.
I was wondering how long it was going to take for you to get that nickname in.
He said, my buddies back home in Lackawanna will fall off their couches if you call me the Ripper. Done and done, Jack.
Great start for the Ripper.
He looks loose, doesn't he?
Man,
watched
he really
him warm-ups and
first of many today.
Man, does he look relaxed.
You heard him say first of many. He was joking with us. I don't think I've ever seen him this loose. And surprisingly, this is only his 11th career TV singles appearance, 27th for that man, Wes Malott. You will not be able to miss him today in that outfit.
Oh, gosh.
2-4-5-8, the bucket.
Well, he left the bucket on his first shot, and as soon as he let go of it, you heard it. Wide right.
Nice, solid pickup. Runner-up last year in the Shark Championship.
This is Malott's first TV appearance of the season here, and whether it's from the fans or his fellow competitors, Wes likes the attention that being the Player of the Year brings.
Do I have a target on my back? I'm sure I do. A lot of guys are having, you know, all eyes on me, and, you know, I'm okay with that. I think they've been on me for the last couple of years. I've been pretty solid. So, you know, I look at it as just another season and going out there and taking care of my business.
And look at that man matriculate that ball down the lane. Nasty. Let's take a look at these two players and how they're playing this oil pattern. Jack Jurek, even though he throws the ball relatively straight, he's still way inside. Wes Malott, higher rev rate, obviously going to be to the left of Jack Jurek. Two ways to get the ball to the pocket.
Wait a second. Did you say matriculate a few sentences ago?
Yeah, I got there from watching SportsCenter.
I think I'm impressed. Not sure. Here's Jurek.
What a strike there for the Ripper. Jurek wired up today for a PBA inside angle. We'll be talking to him in a second.
It's no surprise that Jack made match play in all the name patterns as tough as they've been. Jack is a guy that's not flashy. He's a down and in player. He keeps it in play, doesn't cover a lot of the lane, and makes his spares.
Make it three in a row. All right, Ripper, tell us about your attitude through three so far.
Actually, I think in the last 4 years of TV shows is probably the most comfortable I've felt. And I've got six shows in lately, and it's a little better. It's getting a little easier.
Yeah, it shows from here. Jack, thanks for your time.
Good shot. Good shot.
Back-to-back jacks for Malott.
Rhino Page had Wes Malott on the ropes back in the quarterfinals. Couldn't close the deal, though. And the Big Nasty came back from a 3-1 deficit to capture the match and advance here to the semifinals. Those two set to meet again next week in the semifinals of the PBA World Championship. And you can see it live, 1 p.m. Eastern from Wichita. More on that one coming up in a little bit.
Wes Malott has responded to Jack Jurek's opening onslaught. It is a tight one here from Thunderbowl in Detroit.
Welcome back to the World Series of Bowling and the Shark Championship, semifinal number two. While we're away, Jack Jurek struck in the fourth. Same thing in the fifth. Wes Malott in the fifth. Left the 10 pin. Would get all 10 to drop in the sixth. Now Jurek looking to crack open a six-pack. Knocks them all down!
My!
Oh, it's somebody's day! It's somebody's day!
Play on, play out.
Can I have a re-rack, please?
Yeah, he needs a break after that last shot. What a huge break. This could have been a big four. Look, the big four was up.
I've never seen a seven hold on that long. The smile gives it away.
There were four pins laying on the deck. That's sick stuff, bro. Sick.
Both of Jack's parents made the trip to be here to watch their son. There you see Jack's dad, Jerry, over his shoulder there wearing the white shirt.
Look out.
All good things must come to an end, but what an opening start for Jack Jurek. But let's stress this, as we've been talking about it all tournament long here at the World Series of Bowling. That 29-pin lead in the seventh is far from safe.
Right.
As hot as he has been to open this up, just one little opening is all people need here.
Keep in mind, the Big Nasty, known for throwing a lot of strikes, can still strike out and shoot 269. Look out. Ooh.
Woo!
Like he was going to chop it for a minute. Jack Jurek stays clean. Big Wes Malott looking to get right back in this. But he knows exactly what he needs to do. He's got to start striking.
It was interesting talking to Wes about his goals for this year. He said, yeah, you know, it would be nice to repeat player of the year. That's a big one. But the biggest thing for him now, right now, he's got a little Norm Duke in him in the sense that he wants to concentrate more on the majors. He wants to get that first major on his resume, and conveniently enough, next week he will be bowling in Wichita at the PBA World Championships.
Just like that.
Think Wes liked it?
Yeah, talk some smack to those pins, Big Nasty.
I can just feel the energy, man. It's just redonkulous in here right now.
Yeah, these two have really picked things up here at Thunderbowl.
Like that. Same thing, come on.
Five strikes through the opening seven frames. It has been a clean match on both sides. Misses the head pin.
1, 2, 4, 10, washout.
And hello, washout.
Well, take a look at what he did in the sixth frame on this lane. Still inside that sixth arrow, that ball faces up perfectly. The last shot he just threw right here, the washout, judging by the cat's numbers, to me, he missed it at the release point at the bottom of the swing, causing the ball to blow right through the break point.
First open frame of this match. either competitor. Jack up 35, the Ripper, to close out the eighth. And he has just been given a gift as if he needed more today. Back on the strike train.
Let's take a look at Jack Jurek's release. He's got a little bit of wrist movement, but he still stays underneath it and rolls it pretty good. See how the wrist opens, back to flat, and then a little rotation on the way through. But I think his strong suits are that he is in great shape. He posts up the shot. He's very balanced at the foul line, all keys to making good shots.
You talk about great shape. He hired a personal trainer this offseason, dropped about 10 pounds and 5% body fat.
That's better.
Watch out, folks. Watch out for the Ripper. My goodness.
Hey, Jack, when Wes Malott left that washout, did that loosen up the swing a bit?
No, but I knew that was the time to just shut the door.
You did that, my friend. Thank you.
Thank you.
Eight strikes in nine frames for Jurek.
So bad. And you heard him say it was just a bad shot. He can't believe, you know, hey, where did that come from?
So it's not looking like this is going to be Wes's day, but he will be facing Rhino Page next week in Wichita at the PBA World Championship, a guy he actually beat to get here, Randy.
He also beat him at the King of Bowling Series in the summer. He's been beating up on Rhino Page as of late. And if I know Rhino like I think I know Rhino, Rhino's got payback on his mind.
North Rock Lanes, Wichita, Kansas, live coverage on ESPN, 1 p.m. Eastern. Next Sunday.
There it is.
Well, that's pretty. That one was pretty, Wes.
Good one, baby. Thanks, buddy. Wow. This almost feels like a victory lap for a change. Really ready for that ball just yet.
Doing some experimenting?
Absolutely. He went to it. Looked like a shinier ball, and that wasn't the right one because it was laughing as it was in full skid going down the lane.
So it'll be Jack Jurek versus Michael Fagan, the veteran looking for his second career singles title versus the 28-year-old seeking his first. That is coming up later. But after the break, the women take to the lane for their title match. Kelly Kulick against CDB Carolyn Dorin-Ballard. The PBA Shark Championship is brought to you by Track, evolutionary, revolutionary. By Columbia, Columbia bowls the world over. By Atonic, visit www.atonic.com/bowl. And by Barbasol, enjoy the rush, America. New Barbasol Pacific Rush Shaving Cream. So semi number two on the men's bracket is in the books. Jack Jurek taking down Wes Malott 255 to 213. Up now, the PBA Women's Series presented by Bowl.com. And it's our title match, Kelly Kulick versus Carolyn Dorin-Ballard. Kulick has already won here at the World Series of Bowling, taking the opening event. That was the Women's World Championship, where she beat Shannon Pluhowski. And that was a big feat, considering that Pluhowski went on to capture two World Series titles of her own after that, beating Liz Johnson and Carolyn Dorin-Ballard, CDB, back to try her luck again. Kelly Kulick will begin.
Two, four, eight, ten on a very slick, oily shark pattern. Easy to do, especially when you're playing as deep as she's playing right out of the get-go. All you got to do is get it just a little bit. Look at all the oil on her bowling ball right there. Is that ridiculous?
And look at, there's another huge swath of it. Look at that. It's an oil slick. Here's Carolyn Dorin-Ballard, two career PBA Women's Series titles, trying to win one for the third consecutive year.
And Rob, let me just say this. This oil pattern is right up her alley because she can go straight and she doesn't have to worry about her ball placking when it gets to the puck. As you look at the closeness and the averages, Kelly Kulick actually a bit better in match play, but Carolyn Dorin-Ballard likes to go straight and she loves the heavy oil.
Want to remind you, the men's title match still to come. Michael Fagan taking on Jack Jurek. Two straight approaches and two strikes.
And because of the length of the oil pattern, 43 feet, you can see just how subtle the back end reaction is. Watch this. Even though there's a lot of oil, you can see that the players still have to play the middle part of the lane. That's because there's 100 units of oil outside second arrow on both sides.
It's like the Exxon Valdez is out wide.
Kelly gets her first strike after an open frame first, and one of the best matches of the entire World Series of Bowling occurred in the Shark semifinals between Kulick and Liz Johnson. It was a seven-game back-and-forth seesaw affair, and here's Kelly talking about it.
10th frame, she needed 9 on her first ball, and she could have missed it, and she would have won. So if she left 7 something makeable, she still could have a chance to beat me. But when she went through the nose, I looked at her score, and I'm like, she has to make this. Obviously, when she didn't, I literally had, the best way to describe it is the deer in the headlight look. Like, oh my God, I just won this match.
No deer in the headlights look for Kelly right now. She is all business today.
And on this shark oil pattern, the straighter you throw it, the more difficult this pattern becomes because of the deep inside angle that you have to play. Look at how straight Carolyn Dorin-Ballard is playing this oil pattern because of her rev rate. Kelly Kulick has a much higher rev rate. She can move farther to the left and now open up the lane and create more angle to the pocket.
We saw Carolyn in the spring, Randy, at the Women's Series Showdown. That event featured the Petraglia, scoring system. 20 straight strikes she strung together during that outing. One of the more remarkable bowling things I have witnessed in my career.
So she stays clean through three.
Got around that one just a little bit early, so the ball never bit. To get the bowling ball to adhere to the lane surface, when they're this slick, you got to keep your hand underneath it and roll it. She gets around the side of that one just a pinch, and that causes the ball to scoot all the way to the back of the pin deck, only leaving the two pin.
Skinny jeans. Take it down. CDB with an early lead through three and a half.
The conclusion when we return. We welcome you back to our continuing coverage of the World Series of Bowling from just outside of Detroit. Our thanks to that man, Tom Strobel, and really all of his staff. Tom, the proprietor here at Thunderbowl Lanes, he and his crew have been wonderful hosts for us. While we're away, Kulick in the fourth.
Roll, carry. Yeah.
Drop and give me 10. And then leaves the 1-2-4-10 in the fifth. But is able to convert the spare. CDB in the fifth. Left the 3-10 split. But was able to pick it up. And in the sixth, she leaves the seventh, but was able to convert the spare. All even as Kulick steps up here in the sixth. Through the nose on that one.
And how many times do we see overcompensation from a shot that goes light? The second shot to follow that is usually always a pull, and that's exactly what happened. It's a crazy thing what your mind does to the body when right before you let go of it, you just flinch just enough because you don't want to leave another washout, and it's just enough to make the ball go high.
Yeah, so instead she's staring down a challenging 3-6-10.
And again, on tough oil patterns, tough lane conditions, it's missed spares that end up coming back to haunt players. So an even match went to 14 in one frame.
That's going high.
And high it is, big four. She stares down now in the seventh. She was able to clean up a washout earlier. This one would be history if she can drop it.
It's only been made once in the history of television, Walter A. Williams Jr.
Well, Carolyn Dorin-Ballard made two finals here at the World Series of Bowling, today's Shark Championship and the Chameleon 2 weeks ago, and no one was more surprised than she was.
Chameleon and Shark are my least two favorite, which that's why when I made the show, I'm like, oh my God, and I made Shark last year. It's not that I don't have high expectations, but I put it in perspective, because I know the transition that the lane goes through, and sometimes it can be really good for me, sometimes it can be really bad.
Third strike of the match, but first since the second frame for Carolyn.
And like all good champions, they take advantage of openings. Her opponent goes back-to-back open frames, the Hall of Famer steps up and goes dead flush in the seventh.
Would go a long ways to wrapping up her first title of the season. Up 26, can max out at 215. Could have been a lot worse.
Boy, she looked like she just got quick and fast with that shot. pulled it right through the nose, again leaving the 310. Immediately left the target.
Now, this World Series of Bowling has challenged everyone on television. I mean, it's endurance, it's strength, it's challenging oil patterns. I mean, never will these bowlers be tested like they have been lately.
Next week, we will be live in Wichita, Kansas for the grand finale of the World Series of Bowling. It's the PBA World Championship, first major of the season. PBA Player of the Year last season, Wes Malott, looking for that elusive first major championship. Still hard to believe he hasn't won one yet. He'll go up against 2009 Viper champ Lionel Page. Also in action, the Chameleon champ this year, Bill O'Neill, taking on former auto worker Thomas Smallwood. Make sure to join us live next Sunday, 1 p.m. Eastern.
Made a little adjustment, it looked like, coming off the high shot. Only to leave a four pin. She knows the score. She knows she has to start striking to get back in this match and put some pressure on her opponent.
So Carolyn Dorin-Ballard, 14-pin lead. The 153 as we begin the foundation frame.
Roll.
Kulick finally gets a strike. She was second at the USBC Queens.
Falling to Liz Johnson, trying to avoid another runner-up finish here. Big strike for her, her fourth overall and second on the left lane. Just three strikes for Carolyn Dorin-Ballard, two of them on the right lane that she is on right now.
Well, I talked about what a disadvantage I think it is to be a straight player on this shark oil pattern because of the length of the oil. Here's her shot in the seventh. You can see that ball actually faces up to the pocket. This shot here looks to me like she missed the release point just enough to get the ball to skate, and she almost leaves the lily, which is the 5-7-10. The five goes late.
Ooh, not bad. Like the effort, CDB, but not when you want to have an open frame. Big 10th for Carolyn. Still just one strike on that left lane.
Well, we're going to give her a spare here and good count. So she's going to be 182, 181. It means Kelly Kulick would need one strike, or excuse me, the first strike, the 10th frame, and good count. Kelly Kulick is going to win the Shark Championship. She missed it?
Nope.
Wow.
I don't think she had a lot of confidence, though, about midway down. Yeah. Nope, she didn't.
All right.
Needs 10 here to at least put something on Kelly, but.
8, 9, 10. Kelly needs the first hit.
So 182 for Carolyn Dorin-Ballard. And she is done.
You're good, Kel. Go with your gut. You gotta see the ball, read it.
Last two efforts on the right lane, an open frame and a spare for Kelly.
Boom! What a shot. That is absolutely phenomenal.
Needs seven to win.
We have a winner.
Gutsy move, kiddo. Gutsy move.
How about that comeback?
Since Kulick already qualified for the PBA Women's Series Showdown presented by Bowl.com, by virtue of her win in the Women's World Championship, the qualifier for this event is going to be Carolyn Dorin-Ballard, the runner-up. The end-of-the-season event will be televised on ESPN Sunday, April 18th. Never too early to start planning out your TV bowling schedule. Right, Randy?
I love it.
So Kulick takes it by 15, 197 to 182, her second title here at the World Series of Bowling. When we come back, get set for the men's final. Michael Fagan versus Jack Jurek. $25,000 and a one-year exemption on the line next. It's the Men's Shark Championship. Rob Stone, Randy Peterson back here with you from Thunderbowl Lanes. Michael Fagan looking for his second tour title. First, as a singles player, Jack Jurek looking for his second tour title, his first since 1995.
And let's not forget a berth into the Tournament of Champions.
Michael Fagan, just 28 years of age, from Patch Hog, New York, on Long Island.
Good shot.
Fagan opened up his semifinal match with a three-bagger. Here he leaves the 10.
And take a look where Michael Fagan played the lanes in his first match against Couch. He's just inside of fifth arrow. Well, guess what? He's moved a lot farther to the left. Why? When he had so much success where he was? Because every time a reactive resin ball goes down the lane, it takes oil with it, dries the lane out. The players move in to find more oil.
Cleans that one up, and he'll make way for Jack the Ripper Jurek. And boy, Jurek ripped off an amazing start in his semifinal match versus Wes Malott. Dropped an opening six-bagger en route to a 255.
Let's finish your shots. Come on.
Pure. And a little ball change for Jack the Ripper. Went to a different bowling ball than he used in his first match against Wes Malott, where he shot 250. This guy knows what he's doing. He looks comfortable. He's making some good shots.
We mentioned that he hired a personal trainer in the offseason, dropped about 10 pounds and 5% body fat, and he said, that has really helped me here at the World Series of Bowling, where stamina has become such an important factor. I feel fresh, I feel in a great state of mind. We have never seen him more confident than he is right now. Oh yeah, opening back-to-back jacks from the Ripper. And that one went Brooklyn.
That first match, he put his hand in the ball and he went. Now it looks like he slowed the pace down a bit. And maybe that's because there's a lot more going on internally.
Take a closer look now at Michael Fagan, the Long Island native. Loves that Italian food, especially
the New York Italian food.
Good thing he lives in New York.
Awfully convenient. His favorite TV show, Entourage. His favorite album, one of your favorites as well, Jay-Z's Blueprint 3, not to be confused with Blueprint 1 and 2. And he likes to play poker and go to the beach.
Can you play poker while you're at the beach?
You can. It gets a little sandy.
Okay.
There you go, Michael. Fagan is trying to get more compact with the swing, keep that arm swing a little bit more in check. Ditto with the push away. Feels like he's got a little less backswing to him, but it, as you can see, it's still pretty high, but it doesn't seem to come down as quickly. At least that's what he wants, and keep that tempo more consistent. Jack Jurek up now in the third said, "I've had nothing but good things in my mind here in Michigan." 10 pin away from an opening three bagger.
What a good shot, too. Just a ring and 10, and that's okay. You know, when you're Jack Jurek, you're like, okay, a double. I make a great shot here. He's thinking to himself, look at that, right about the 21st board. It's all right. Just come back, cover the spare, go to the next frame.
Jurek remains clean. Strike, strike, spare through three. Lead at 10.
He leads by 10 pins, fourth frame.
Thank you, Mike.
Jack said, if I was going to make any show on this swing, the one that would probably be last that I would pick would be the shark pattern. But little by little, I feel like I'm getting more comfortable on it. And especially this arena bay is really to his liking.
Oh, yeah.
Three strikes to open up the first four frames for Jack Jurek. Jack, what did you tell yourself before this title match started for you?
Well, Rob, it's been such a great month. And all I want to do tonight is just perform relaxed, just bowling with the chips fall where they may. Too many times I've just been had a little anxiety.
Well, Jack, we're enjoying the performance so far. Jack Jurek with an early 10-pin lead. Three strikes through the opening four frames. More from the men's final of the Shark Championship when ESPN's coverage of the PBA returns to Detroit. Rob Stone, Randy Peterson back here with you for the PBA Shark Championship here at the World Series of Bowling. Our men's title match, Jack Jurek taking on Michael Fagan. And here is Fagan in the fourth off his first strike in this match. Leaves the 10. His goals this year, you know, essentially just get better. Get that first singles win under my belt. Wants to make 3 to 4 shows. Any more than that would be great. He made 3 shows last year.
And Rob, shots like that start to create anxiety. You're a little bit behind in the match. You get a strike. You're working on a strike. You went through the nose, the shot before on that right lane. You come back and you peer it, only to leave a ring in 10.
Fagan had a little issue with one of our cameras during the Cheetah Championship here at the World Series of Bowling. He's a player that admits to being easily distracted.
I would say yeah, because I just want to try to stay focused as possible, and you know, I don't want to have to make an excuse after I throw it and say, well, that messed me up. I'd rather just stop and regroup and start over again, because you know, literally, you know, when you're bowling a match like that, one shot is going to make the difference.
There's his second strike of this match. Fagan had 8 strikes in his semifinal win over Jason Couch en route to a 224. Back up, Jack Jurek, who dropped a 255 and an opening 6-bagger on Wes Malott in his semifinal.
This is where Jack wants to lay down the hammer. Oh. You know, you talked about it in that first match he bowled against Wes, where he caved in the big four to keep his string of strikes alive. Right here, he does the same thing, working on a strike. Check this out. How about trip 4, 7, 9?
That's a double, my friend.
When things are going your way, they are going your way.
When it's your time, it's your time. When it's your day, it doesn't matter. Talk to any professional bowler that's ever bowled out on this tour, that's ever won. It just doesn't matter.
And he felt this was his day, not just this morning. I mean, he's had this good feeling going through him for a while. And boy, did we jinx him with a big four.
That was pretty good, too.
Well, Jack obviously liked that shot. Now, here's the difference between the shot he just threw and the one that he threw in the fourth frame. Here's the fourth frame. Perfect, 10 back. The very next shot mirrors the last, but it goes high. The reason why? Jack Jurek is so much farther right than Wes Malott and Mike Fagan, he's actually throwing it right into their hook spot.
That's his first open frame today.
It wasn't that bad. Let's make the move.
Now, if you're in the Jurek camp, the good news is he doesn't seem all that fazed by it. If you're in the Fagan camp, the good news is you're only down two, working off a strike here in the sixth.
And knowing that if he doubles up right here, he can take the lead for the first time in this match. Well, it looked good as far as direction, but it wasn't as pure as it needed to be off of his hand. That's why the 10 pin is still standing.
Fagan drove here from Long Island, about a 12, 13 hour drive. Came with Jason Belmonte. Told me he's driving home tomorrow solo. It's going to be a long drive, particularly if he doesn't win this one. We ask you and remind you to head on over to PBA.com to check out Extra Frame, the PBA's online subscription video service. Some of the many features of Extra Frame include some of that exclusive player interviews, live early round tournament coverage, and a brand new highlight show called 39 by 60. Click on the Extra Frame link at PBA.com to sign up today. They have really upgraded Extra Frame at PBA.com. We open up the seventh. Here's Fagan. Three strikes in a row on the left lane for Fagan.
But you saw the graphic, he's yet to strike on the right lane, and he finishes the match on the right lane.
Jurek has four strikes, two on the left, two on the right. The big four coming on the left, the last frame.
And for the first time, Jack is in a different position than he's been the entire day. All of a sudden now it's, well, you know what? I've only got a two-pin lead if I spare here. Michael Fagan's working on a strike. Remember the Wes Malott match? What do you have, a six-bagger there? He was all over Wes Malott like a bulldog on a pork chop. Not the case in this match.
Remember, Jurek started off the semifinal versus Wes Malott, dropping an opening six-bagger, had an eight spare, and then another pair of strikes. So he was in a comfort zone from the get-go. You saw it on his look, you saw it in his walk, you saw it in his stroke. And this the first bit of adversity he has faced today. And again, you know, somewhere in the back of his head, he's thinking 1995, last time he won a title.
Now hook.
There you go, Ripper.
Jack.
Gets the deck to drop. You know, he says it's unique in the fact that I haven't won in so long. On the one side, you know, look, it shows I'm a model of perseverance. It's not a burden, but he admits, you know, it's a monkey on my own back personally. No one else is putting it on him but him. And yes, he would like to get rid of it. Those monkeys are a lot of upkeep.
Got a chance.
Oh, put on the brakes. That was eyeballing the 10.
Has yet to strike on the right lane, a two-pin match. This one's coming down to the wire. Messenger in front.
That was the head pin. have not seen a lot of messenger action out here today.
Three 10 pins, the last three shots right. on the right lane for Michael Fagan. That would have made the 7-10, just so you know.
All right, we said a lot of play back there. If a 7-10 is going to get dropped, we have a great chance of seeing it here. Fagan down two. We open up the foundation frame.
All right, we've got to move on this lane.
Two frames left. Separated by two pins are Michael Fagan and Jack Jurek.
Yeah.
Drops the rack, does Fagan.
So much on the line, like you talked about earlier. Michael Fagan looking to win for the first time in a singles event. Everything that goes with that. Jack Jurek looking to make PBA history, trying to become a player who has the longest streak between wins. Jack Jurek would be the owner of that title if he were to win today.
It would be 14 years and 175 days between titles. Oh, big strike for Jack.
Double.
So that's back-to-back Jurek. Jacks for the Ripper.
You said big strike? That's mungus, as in humongous. Setting up the 10th frame, he can strike out now to shoot 231 and shut out Michael Fagan. Michael Fagan's best now, 219.
He says, at 46 years of age, it's the best I've ever felt.
Oh, how about it? How about it?
How about that?
He needs nine on this next ball.
I have one left. Not yet.
Nine spare. Jack Jurek wins again, finally.
He was asking, I have one re-rack left, and I like it when he says, not yet.
Finish it like a champ. No, Jack.
Michael Fagan can still win this. Bad shot by Jack Jurek, pulled way left.
That's 15 years of waiting right there.
He needs to cover all three to force Michael Fagan to get all three.
And you heard him say 15 years of waiting right there on that shot. He has handled it magnificently until that moment in the 10th.
That's as big as any strike he'll throw, because now it forces Fagan to get all three on the lane that Michael Fagan has yet to strike on. Three consecutive 10 pins for Michael Fagan, all on the right lane. Now he must find a way to throw three strikes.
And Jurek is going to watch this one from the bench. Fagan with four strikes in the match. Again, none on this right lane. Gutsy, one down.
Rob, this is the kind of situation that every player dreams of, being able to perform in the 10th frame to win. Mike Fagan is in that position right now.
Two strikes away from his first singles title. One slip up, and it'll be Jack Jurek putting the end to a mammoth winless streak. Yeah!
And not an ounce of emotion coming out of Michael Fagan. Smart, smart play. Jack Jurek knows he would have just gotten nine spare.
That seven pin dropped late. A strike. Fagan wins his first singles title.
Nine, we have a tie and a roll off.
Eight or less, Jurek has the title. Didn't like it? Back off.
Big, big shot.
Arguably the biggest shot of young Michael Fagan's career. The 28-year-old steps back. Jack Jurek, the 46-year-old, sits and waits for the result. Messenger, no!
We have a tie!
Wow. 218 to 218. Does it get any better?
Any better way to finish this, Mr. Silver? How is this for a finish, right? Good shot.
Ladies and gentlemen, by PBA rule, this tie game must be decided by a one-ball sudden-death roll-off. Jack Jurek, the higher seed, will have choice of starting lane and order. Jack Jurek is elected to start the match on the right lane. If the tie remains after their first shots, they'll move to the other lane in the same order and continue alternating back and forth until the tie is broken.
Higher seed has the choice of lane and order. Jack Jurek is your higher seed. He has decided he wants to start, and he wants to pick and bowl on the right lane.
Think about the two strikes that Michael Fagan threw in the 10th frame on that lane. Both real light, comes back with a really good shot, only to leave another 10-pin to force sudden death.
I never said it'd be easy. All right.
Gets them all to kick. Pressure to the youngster.
Well, I'll tell you what, if you're not excited watching this, you don't have a pulse. Jack Jurek just manned up and threw 10 down.
Fagan with two strikes on the right lane, both of them coming in the 10th.
Make sure it's right.
We saw him do that in the 10th as well.
That's right.
Didn't like what he saw and had in front of him. Regroup.
Wow.
Way off target. Jurek can celebrate for the first time in 14 years. And 175 days, the Rippers got another title.
Jack said how important this event would be, particularly for his father, Jerry, with good health but poor mobility. He is a lot of what I am out there right now, and Jack made it a point. I want to thank him for all he has done for me. It's going to take a while for this one to sit in for Jack. Here is Fagan in the roll-off. Was offline from the get-go. Needed the strike to push this event to another roll-off. There'll be another day for you, Michael. But today, it belongs to Jack Jurek.
The PBA Shark Championship is brought to you by Lumber Liquidators, hardwood flooring for less. By GEICO, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. By Bayer Aspirin, expect wonders. And by the United States Bowling Congress, the all-new bowl.com, your online source for all things bowling. Log on to bowl.com today.
So Jack Jurek, with his parents in attendance, gets that mammoth monkey off his back, his first career title in 14 years and 175 days.
and here's how he did it. Randy, time now for the Geico Championship recap.
Okay, Rob, Jack Jurek gets up in the 10th frame, needing a strike and nine spare to shut out Fagan. He gets the strike, but only gets seven on the second ball in the 10th when he leaves a 3-6 dead. Now it's Fagan's chance. If he gets three in the 10th, he wins. He gets two, leaves a 10-pin, and guess what? We're off to the roll-off. Jack Jurek gets up and strikes. Now it's Michael Fagan's turn. He flags the head pin. Jack Jurek wins his second career title.
So Jurek is the fifth PBA versatility swing qualifier for the PBA Experience Showdown presented by Bull.com. The sixth and final spot for this event. Yeah, interesting. It's going to be filled by an amateur selected from a PBA Experience League. An amateur gets to roll with some of the best, including Norm Duke and Ryan O'Page, Bill O'Neill, Mike Devaney. The special end-of-the-season event will be televised here on ESPN in mid-April, April 11th. And here's Randy with our winner.
Thanks, Rob. Jack, I know it's been an awful long time. Describe the emotions you're feeling now.
Randy, I wish words could come to me right now, but there's been so much time put into this. I mean, the last 3 months I've worked more time off the lanes than I did on the lanes, and this month has been unbelievable, and what a way to just cap it off. I mean, I have my mom and dad here. For my dad to see another win, is it means more than anything.
Congratulations. Enjoy it.
Absolutely. Rob, bless you. Thank you.
And don't forget to join us next Sunday live at the PBA World Championship. Come on, Wichita, bring the signs. Wes Malott versus Ryan O'Page, with Bill O'Neill taking on Thomas Smallwood. It's the first major of the season, live next Sunday, 1 Eastern. For Randy Peterson and our entire crew, I'm Rob Stone. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.